swing, sling, brace, matrix, glenohumeral joint, broken down a little bit more and a little bit further in other sections of our dwelling space. I highlight and actually go after specific pathological conditions, whether it's post-surgical intervention or not. So we can be a little more specific, but with regards to our strategies in this healing process involved with the glenohumeral joint, wanted to be a little bit more specific than our intro video, because this is some pretty, some pretty detailed stuff, very pivotal stuff as well. With regards to any kind of surgical intervention, I will say it's always interesting on a weekly basis getting and receiving these mandates and these protocols from physicians that blatantly state our precautions and contraindications. And don't get me wrong, we're very obedient with regards to those, but from a scientific and a truthful understanding at the physiological level, we just know that that the patient doesn't deserve for us to take this very sheltered and watered down, generic, non-customized approach, prescribing themselves to the opioids, non-movement, proprioceptively and mechanoreceptively deadened positions. We stand to lose out on a great sensitivity to the healing process. So I hope to, in this video, kind of talk a little bit more with regards to the glenohumeral joint, what's driving what, and maybe throw in there a couple hypothetical situations with regards to our post-op precautions and contraindications. So right scapula facing you, anterior, posterior, front and back. So what this guy is capable of doing, so scapula, 17 muscles attached to it, sits atop the rib cage. Rib cage, thoracic spine, scapulothoracic joint is what it is made out to be. So scapula, we have the ability of this guy three-dimensionally with regards to our motion. We can slide up and down, so superior, inferior, medial, and lateral. We can also retract and protract. We can also posteriorly and anteriorly rotate. We can also laterally and medially rotate, external or internal rotation. And we can also upwardly or kind of downwardly rotate with the scapula. With this guy in a sling, for instance, or a brace, or taking them off as we often like to do very soon post-op, depending on the individual and the right frame of time. This guy right here, as we've noted with our previous videos with the actual sling on to mimic a sling or a brace, we had a lot of other things moving. We had a nose, a head and eyes, or a non-affected side working and being used as a driver, as well as a bottom-up sequence of drivers with our stability and mobility matrices and our single toe touchdown series with pendulum swings. If we remember back and take a look at that, we have a humerus that pretty much is just kind of hanging out and in place. So typical prescription, let's look at a bicipital tenodesis, also known as your slap lesion repair, post tear of the bicep. So for a good, at least, depending on the surgeon, depending again on the age of the individual, the co-contaminants we call them. So was there other things involved? So in this case, the bicipital, so the slap lesion, the tenodesis, was there rotator cuff involvement? How many anchors were used? Literally, there's some patients that we'll get on into, and the quality of the tissue is very different, and I'll sometimes relay it to an individual once in a while where it's almost like a wet newspaper. So there's certainly a uniqueness within the healing process of everybody individually. But let's take that. So slap tear, we're told that, okay, for a good 8 weeks, the uninvolvement of active range of motion for glenohumeral joint flexion, abduction, and internal rotation must be avoided. Flexion of the elbow, supination of the forearm, avoid. So it's that production of motion, so concentrically, would contraindicate us being able to protect the repair that the surgeon has made. So that's been also taken to, okay, after maybe 6 weeks, we can begin what we call our passive range of motion activities, supine on a table, and then we can progress into our active range of motion, and then our passive active range of motion after our active assisted range of motion. Rotator cuff repairs, let's say we're talking about the supraspinatus, okay, avoid post-op or abduction and external rotation. Same thing, you're in that sling for a good 6 to 8 weeks, and we have certain motions, again, like the external rotation, abduction that we need to avoid, but we're going to be put on a table. We're going to go through some passive range of motion type stuff, active assisted, and then to our active range of motion. Well, again, our concern is the authenticity in which that collagen is laid down and the fact that that collagen is laid down. We'll take a look at the NSAIDs and the opioids and how that actually prohibits the healing process from taking place. So we keep that in mind and we go after eliminating that, and we use motion and movement as a way to stimulate all these cool little mechanoreceptors that we have embedded within our joint capsules and the rest of our fascia that will help override the pain stimulus sent back up to the brain. And so a pretty cool thing that we can do with movement right there. So let's say that the left upper extremity is the affected side, and this is what you're looking at right here in terms of shoulder. We're using, let's go back a little bit here, let's go back a little bit here to the spine model. So scapulothoracic joint minus the rib cage right here. So we're using the thoracic spine, so extension and flexion, left side bend, right side bend, left rotation, right rotation, and then we get into our type 1 and type 2 motions. Same side rotation, side bend, opposite side, in sync and out of sync, pertaining to the pelvic and the shoulder girdle arrangement in relation to each other. So pivotal that we use the thoracic spine and scapulothoracic joint on the opposite unaffected side, as well as the hip complex, to help create the motion that we're looking for. So something very simple, let's say if my left upper extremity is affected and I'm hanging out in my sling and my brace, let's resort back to, just as a review, let's go back to our little 3D lunge pivot pendulum swing matrices right here. So the right arm in the sagittal plane is driving us. Frontal plane, same side, the opposite side, frontal plane lunge, right upper extremity, right lower extremity are driving us, and then the same side, opposite side, transverse pendulum swing. We did a fair amount of work in terms of hanging onto the cage, depending on where they are in that progression, as well as our pendulum swing with the dowel. If we were to take a look at then this left upper extremity, this left glenohumeral joint, and what it is actually doing, this humerus right here, so what is the shoulder joint? Well, it's the glenohumeral joint, it's the glenoid. So glenoid on the humerus, or humerus on the glenoid, head of the humerus. Most unstable joint that we have within our system, the glenoid right here. So portion of the scapula, this guy, in terms of the surface area and space, is about a third of what the head of the humerus is. So we've got a small little space right there that these guys are kind of riding on. So in terms of affecting the healing process, well, we can have a top-down or bottom-up effect with regards to this healing process. And right now, due to the individual being so acute and freshly kind of post-op, or maybe acutely just kind of chronically flared up, we're going to use everything around it to affect that joint. We know that from an applied functional science perspective that we can take the scapulothoracic joint, which is then therefore going to affect the glenohumeral joint. So if I'm taking you through our lunge kind of pendulum swing matrix in the sagittal plane, if we are, and that arm right here is in a brace, we've got the scapula that is tilting anteriorly and posteriorly on the humerus. Humerus is just kind of hanging out. We have that same thing taking place in the frontal plane with our same side to opposite side frontal plane lunge, and then the same thing with our same side and opposite side transverse plane. Sorry, the hardware is limiting right here, guys, but you can kind of picture in terms of the lateral and also the medial rotation of the scapula. Okay, so in terms of our flexion and extension motion in the sagittal plane at the shoulder, left shoulder right here, we have, and we'll go back to taking a look at this guy in a second here as well. If that humerus is just hanging out, and if I'm reaching, so a little posterior reach overhead with my right anterior lunge, my thoracic spine is extending. It's flexing right here. When I move into extension of the thoracic spine, this may be different than a typical overhead activity. Again, we're trying to get the motion. Motion is what is ultimately helping to create this collagen reproduction in terms of laying down this new tissue and to help us resist deformity. So authenticity-wise of the motion that we're producing is pretty good. We're up off the table, up out of this proprioceptively deadened position. The body is forcing itself to control this motion and using motion to lay down this new collagen, these new proprioceptors. So it's overhead right here with this posterior reach that I'm actually, with the glenohumeral joint, getting extension. I get a posterior tilt right here of the scapula. So a posterior tilt, posterior rotation, little elevation of that scap. So, and when I move down and transition into flexion with my posterior lunge with the right leg right here, the scapula is rotating anteriorly, which is then from a side angle right here, which is then going to give me flexion of the glenohumeral joint. So up overhead with the posterior reach with the right upper extremity, scapula is passing the humerus. I'm getting extension of the glenohumeral joint. And with my posterior pendulum swing and my right posterior lunge, I am getting flexion of the glenohumeral joint. Scapula passes the humerus. So again, extension and then also flexion right there. Transition to the frontal plane. Same side lateral to opposite side lateral, lunge right here, boom, and boom. That humerus hanging out, and the thoracic spine being driven with a left side bend to a right side bend as I come back down and underneath with my driver right here. I'm getting with my right same side lateral lunge, I'm getting abduction of the glenohumeral joint. And then with my opposite side lateral lunge and pendulum swing, I'm getting adduction of the glenohumeral joint. So AB and adduction. Transverse plane, same side and opposite side transverse plane. I am